Welcome to our daily devotion. The Methodist Church of Barbados invites you to sing, pray, and worship with us as we declare God's glory and celebrate His mighty acts.
Loving God, as we come before you tonight, we worship you and we praise you, O God. You are the God who has loved us and continues to love us with an everlasting love. You are the God who is interested and invested in our well-being. You are the God, a good God, who says to us that your desire is that no one will perish. but that all will come to repentance. You are the God who is being patient with us. You are the God who is constantly using life and even the bad, even the evil. You are the God who is so powerful, so sovereign, so providential, and is using everything, working everything together for our good. And so, oh God, we worship and we honor you. We bless your name. We bow down before you, O God, and declare that you are God and God alone. We confess, O God, that we have allowed at times our love for you to waver. We confess, O God, that we have many times taken our relationship with you for granted. We confess, O God, that we have at many times become so caught up in the affairs of the world and the cares of the world. We find little to no time to commune with you, to worship you. So, O God, for these things we are sorry. And we come seeking your forgiveness, your cleansing, your healing. So that, O God, you will help us, restore us. So that, O God, we can worship you in spirit and in truth. So bless our time, mighty God. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Our scripture reading for today comes to us from Luke chapter 10, reading verses 38 to 42. Now, as they went on their way, he entered a certain village where a woman named Martha welcomed him into her home. She had a sister named Mary who sat at the Lord's feet and listened to what he was saying. But Martha was distracted by her many tasks. So she came to him and asked, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to do all the work by myself? Tell her then to help me." But the Lord answered her, "Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her." This is the gospel of Christ. Praise be to Christ, our Lord.
Shalt be thy friends in thy conduct, his light darkness shall see. Take time to be holy. Let Him be thy guide. And run not before Him. Whatever betide, in joy or in sorrow, still follow the Lord. And look into Jesus, still trust in His word. To be holy, be calm in thy soul. Each thought and each motive beneath His control. Thus led by His Spirit to fountains of love, shalt be fitted for service above.
Brothers and sisters, as we reflect tonight on God's word, let us go to God in prayer. Dear God, we are truly thankful for your word, which is lamp to our feet and light to our path in a dark world. We thank you for bringing us into your marvelous light. And oh God, we pray that as we reflect, help us to open our hearts and our minds and our souls so that your word can take root, and so that, oh God, we can walk in your light and give glory to your name. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Tonight I invite us to reflect on the need for a Mary's heart in a Martha's world. The need for a Mary's heart in a Martha's world. And I invite us to think for a while about the world that we live in. In our homes, in today's world, we frowned upon stay-at-home wives and mothers. We say that they are not getting the opportunity to pursue their career and dreams. We even term certain things like these as patriarchal and enslaving. In the church, many members could testify that they are very active in their local church, that they are in various groups, they hold different positions, they organize different initiatives. But often when asked about their personal devotional life, there is an embarrassed look or a shaky confession. Well, I don't really read my Bible, but I pray most times. In the society, we have many who are a part of social justice issues and who are activists and who are part of many volunteer groups that are making significant contributions. However, when you check the lives of sometimes persons who are involved in these groups, their character is questionable, or some may not even have any belief in God. Unfortunately, the world we live in is one that many times determines quality by quantity and defines us by our activity. But I believe Jesus is challenging his church to a different standard, which requires nurturing a Mary's heart in a Martha's world. When we read Luke chapter 10, had it not been for Jesus' response to Martha, I believe most of us would have believed that Martha was doing what any reasonable and kind-hearted human being would do, and that Mary was indeed being unreasonable. But because of Jesus' response to Martha, we are challenged to investigate why does Jesus, our Lord and Savior, say that Mary has chosen the better part. However, just the fact that we would be quicker to celebrate Martha's choice tells us that Martha's actions are more in keeping with the culture and norms of the world. How Martha has chosen to honor Jesus and to use her time just seems like what any good human being would do. We live in a Martha's world, a world where Martha's way and approach to life is the norm, even in the church. And by a Martha's world, I mean further, a world that is fast-paced and always keeps us busy. When we wake up in the morning, it is time to jump out of bed, grab our phones, check our messages, check the news, check the social media, set our to-do list for the day. It is time to prepare for the day ahead, to go to the gym, to get breakfast to ready, get lunch ready, to get the family ready. Then afterwards, I go to work, have a productive day, make sure my checklist is done, or I go to school for most of the day, and then we may have our extracurricular activities and church activities in the evening. When we get home, the day has ended and it is time to get ready for the new day, and we press repeat. You see, our busyness and our many tasks, because many things are good in and of themselves, they make our lives feel accomplished and fulfilled, but according to the characteristics of a Martha's world, they serve as distractions from a real, authentic relationship and connection with God. And yes, I am certainly speaking about church activities too, because it is especially those kinds of activities for Christians, like choir practice and fellowship and planning committees, that make us feel fulfilled and make us feel as if we are on the right track with God, but many times can serve as distractions from our relationship with God. It is a world that is activity-oriented and driven. What must I do? What am I doing with my life? What is next? You see, it is a world where we find our worth in what we do. Interestingly, in that same chapter, verse 20, Jesus says to the 70 who he sent out after their excitement over authority, having authority over demons, he says, "Nevertheless, do not rejoice at this, that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven." In other words, Jesus was saying to them, don't find joy simply in what you do and what you are able to do, but find joy even more and fulfillment and satisfaction in your relationship with God, in the fact that you can be reconciled with God, in the fact that you are able to spend eternity with God. Rather, a Martha's world keeps us looking for the next thing to do, the next thing to achieve, the next thing to be involved in, because the activities are a source of our validation before God and others. It makes us, brothers and sisters, a Martha's world makes us become impatient and less tolerant to anything that will cause us to feel inactive. So we would say things like, "I know you have to pray now, but you have to get practical." Words like waiting or being patient, waiting on God, doesn't settle well in a Martha's world. Wait, but we still have the issues. We still have the bills. Things are still going on. A Martha's world sees going outside of the four walls of the church building as more important and more critical than being in prayer, coming to Bible study, fasting, discerning, wrestling, and getting direction from God. Martha's world tells us that, you know, when we engage in these things on the inside, we are not meeting the real world. Martha's world is always ready to get on the street, speak to every issue. It is because of a Martha's world that the church started and has begun adopting teaching from Karl Marx and others as practical solutions to changing society, because we just can't wait anymore, and resents the idea of a church that wants to wait on the Lord through prayer and fasting. But Jesus says to Martha, and I am contending that he is saying to Christians in a Martha's world, Martha, Martha, you are worried and distracted by many things. There is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, which will not be taken away from her. Jesus is calling us, brothers and sisters, not to conform to a Martha's world, but to be transformed by the renewing of our minds, to experience for ourselves that Mary has chosen the better part. Mary may seem lazy, inactive, missing in action in a Martha's world, but Mary is building what truly matters. Mary is preparing for lasting and effective ministry and service in this world. So how do I nurture Mary's heart? First thing I like to suggest is we have to make our relationship with God our number one priority. You see, to make something a number one priority is to give it more importance and attention than everything else. You see, Jesus says to Martha, Martha, you are worried by too many things. There is need of only one thing. You hear the language, one thing. What is this one thing? See, if we survey chapter 9 into chapter 10, there's a recurring message that there are many reasonable, noble, and cultural, normal choices in life. But Jesus is calling his followers to reject even the good things and radically choose the better part. Even the language better means that there are many good things available to do, but Jesus has the better way. This is a call to invest in our relationship with God more than anything else. When we rise in the morning, shut away social media, shut away the phones, bring under subjection all the thoughts and all the tasks we have to achieve for the day, and set personal time with God. Discipline ourselves. Create boundaries around that time. Guard it jealously. Fight for it relentlessly. Rearrange our time, brothers and sisters, and life, and let it revolve around enriching our relationship with Christ. Let us have no more excuses for Bible study and prayer and meeting and worship and small group meetings, but go after our relationship with God with all of our heart. Ensure that nothing or no one is made a higher priority than your relationship with Christ. Anything and anyone that forces you to do so needs to be brought under subjection. And secondly, we need to submit to the Lordship of Jesus. In verse 40, Martha calls him Lord, but her confession does not match her fruit. She calls him Lord, but is still too busy to build relationship with him. How many times we are so active and busy, but just can't find time to sit with God and listen to him. And she calls him Lord, and still wants to do what she believes will please him, and does not ask him what will please him. See, but verse 39, it tells us that Mary refuses to go and be so busy and sits at the Lord's feet and listen to what he's saying. You see, while Mary doesn't speak much, her actions are showing us her inward confession, her posture and position before Jesus communicates that she is not just gaining knowledge, but she is prepared to allow the teaching to alter her life, to allow the word to sink deep in her heart, brothers and sisters. Her position demonstrates that her heart is prepared to be obedient to God. I am listening to God so that I could know how to live. I could know what he expects of my life. And I am prepared to make whatever change, to go wherever he sends me, to do whatever he says, even if it doesn't make sense, even if it doesn't line up with what I may want, even if it calls me to make a sacrifice. We need to submit to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Too many persons and too many Christians are reading words at times and doing things, but are not willing to submit to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. And lastly, we must always act out of our relationship with God. I know it's so many issues in our world and needs, so many people lost. There's the temptation to always believe that we have been praying too long. We have been talking too long. We just need to act. We just need to get out there. We just need to speak up. It is a very real struggle that Martha had. If I have Jesus in my home, reasonable thing, I need to show him hospitality. And as good as that is, Martha was trying to do things she thinks Christ would like, or doing what she wants to do for Christ. But brothers and sisters, but it is not but about what we want to do for Christ or what we do for Christ. But it is more about what we do with Christ. You see, in the early church, we don't see a church picking up and being active and wanting to do what they want. But we see a church that is constantly discerning and constantly looking to God to see where God is leading. You see, our living and ministry that God calls us to is less about being active for God and more about worshiping God through our living. Our living and what we must do, must always be motivated by and come from a deep love and passionate devotion to God. See, the Samaritan, in the few verses before, tells us that one of the major differences between the Samaritan and the priest and the Levite was that he acted out of compassion, which led him to sacrifice for his neighbor. My brothers and sisters, God does not want busy ambassadors, busy bees, moving here, moving there, and becoming so active. But oh, brothers and sisters, first and foremost, he wants a people who are in communion with him, who love him so much that they are willing to do whatever he wants, whatever is his will. They love him so much that they are not prepared to do what they want, but they just want to know, Lord, what do you want? Lord, I place this day in your hands. Lord, what would you have me do today? Brothers and sisters, let us be careful to nurture Mary's heart. Make your relationship with God your number one priority. Let us stop with the shaky confessions about our daily devotions. Let us submit to the Lordship of Jesus. Let us act always out of our relationship with God. Brothers and sisters, unless we meet Christ personally and privately daily, unless we seek to grow in our love for God, then we will end up like Martha and be overwhelmed by a Martha's world, becoming busy, frustrated and ineffective, but not blessed and glorifying God's name. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Jesus, keep me near the cross. There a precious fountain, free.
Brothers and sisters, I join in the words of the Apostle Paul in Ephesians chapter 3. I pray that you may have the power to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Please receive the benediction, and now to him who by the power at work in us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than all we can ask or imagine. To him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
Sleeping, I am with you. You are.
Thank you for being a part of our daily devotion. We trust it has been a blessing to you. Now together, let us hold fast to His word, and may it dwell in all of us richly.